Okay. So, welcome to everyone. A very good evening to all. Today, the Focolare team is facilitating the session. I suppose now you know me. My name is Caroline. I'm from the Focolare in Mumbai. I come from Malta, but I am in the Focolare of Mumbai. Today we will be giving the story of Chiara Lubich, founder of the Focolare. And to help us with moderating this session, we have Dr. Dipali Bennett. I will briefly introduce her. So Dr. Dipali Bennett is a former associate professor in the Department of Sanskrit at the JDM College, University of Delhi, where she taught for more than 40 years at both the undergraduate and postgraduate levels. She taught papers related to Vedas, Upanishads, Sanskrit literature, and Indian culture. She also has a keen interest in Indian art and culture and the Sanskrit Shilpa Shastras. She has been associated with the various programs, projects, seminars, and workshops organized by the Women's Studies and Development Center, University of Delhi, and served as the coordinator of the Women's Development Center and the certificate course in Women's Study in her college. She has been actively engaged in interfaith activities for more than 3 decades and has participated in a number of national and international interfaith seminars and conferences and presented papers. At present, she is one of the Associate Secretaries General and a member of the Executive Committee of Religions for Peace Asia. She is also the co-chair of the Women of Faith Asia Pacific Network, Religions for Peace Asia. She has been closely associated with the Focolare movement and its activities for many years. She has also conducted a number of interfaith women's journeys in several parts of India for the organization Interfaith Coalition for Peace. As a life member of the Guild of Service, an NGO engaged with women's empowerment, she has passionately worked for the project of the rehabilitation of abandoned widows in Vrindavan for over 2 decades. She has co-edited a book entitled Gender Concerns in South Asia, Some Perspectives. Her special areas of interest are issues related to women and women's empowerment and activities related to interfaith harmony and peace. So, Dr. Bennett, would you like to say a few words?
Thank you, Caroline. Thank you. I'm so happy to be here. And as you have mentioned, I have been associated with the interfaith movement. So, therefore, this Hindu-Christian dialogue is of great interest to me. And each time I participate in such a program, it is always a new learning experience. And each time, and I'm very thankful for the Focolare movement and this Christian Hindu-Christian dialogue. I have attended the past few lectures, and I found them very rewarding and very, very interesting. So I'm so happy to be here. Thank you.
Okay, so I will introduce the speaker for today. Her
Okay.
name is, yes, her name is Sherilyn Meneses from Mumbai. She is from the Focolare. And since September 2017, she is co-responsible of the Mumbai region. She obtained a Bachelor in Commerce and Economics from Sydenham College of Commerce and Economics, Maharashtra, and currently works as a Human Resource and Operations Manager with the India branch of an Italian company. In 2014, she obtained a Master's degree in Foundations and Perspectives for a Culture of Unity with specialization in Trinitarian Ontology from Sophia University Institute, Florence, Italy. And has participated in numerous interreligious formation courses in India and abroad, helping in the organization of a number of Hindu-Christian symposia in Rome and India. Since 2014, she has been lecturing at the University of Mumbai for the Advanced Diploma and Certificate course on Mysticism. An active youth leader and animator, in 2018, she participated as an auditor at the Synod of Bishops at the Vatican on the topic Young People, the Faith, and Vocational Discernment. And since 2019, she is part of the advisory board to the National Youth Commission of the Conference of Catholic Bishops of India. She has contributed with a number of articles in magazines and journals on Hindu-Christian dialogue from the perspective of Kiara Lubich's mysticism and the culture of unity of the Focolare. So I hand over to Sherilyn and to Dipali.
So I can start, Dipali, or would you want to say a few words before I begin?
No, I think because of the paucity of time, I think you can begin. But I am very happy to be here as my with my association with the Focolare movement. It's not very old, but I have many Focolare friends and I have participated in many of their programs. And I find the youth members to be very active. And that is what is needed in an interfaith dialogue, you know, to get close to each other without being judgmental and to be one with, to carry the message of Kiara Lubich. So I think you can start off with your lecture and then we can talk about it after you have made your presentation. Thank you, Kacharilene.
Thank you, Dr. Dipali. In fact, as you might be wondering, sages and saints of India, but Kiara Lubich is not neither a sage nor a saint of India, but she has contributed to the sanctity of many Indians, that's for sure. And her passion for dialogue, especially the Hindu-Christian dialogue, has also brought her to India. So that's why you will find you know, her very relevant in our series of lectures. So I'd like to thank also Father Matthew in a particular way for this initiation of these lectures. And I wanted to let you know that Kiara Lubich's first trip to India was in January 2001, when she was honored with the Defender of Peace Award in Coimbatore, jointly conferred by the Gandhian movements, Shanti Ashram and Sarvodaya. In the presence of important dignitaries and media figures, Dr. Markandan, the then president of the Sarvodaya Association, who read the award citation, began with these words: Kiara Lubich, using the most powerful human force of love and a strong faith in the unity of all humankind as espoused in the teachings of Jesus Christ, has been chosen to play a tireless role in sowing the seeds of peace and love among all peoples. In presenting the award to her, Dr. Markandan also asked Kiara to give particular priority to her work in initiating dialogue with the Hindus, as she had done with other religious leaders across the world. And that's a part of the genesis of the Christian-Hindu dialogue in the Focolare movement. We will have two lessons on Kiara Lubich. In one, we will enter into her contribution to dialogue. And in today's lesson, we will have a glimpse of her life, thoughts, and influence. So I would actually like to start with a clip. I presume many of you may have not met her or may have not heard of Kiara Lubich. And it would definitely help to have a visual idea of the person we are presenting today. But I also want to tell you that in the next few minutes, many realities will strike you one after the other. Because through this video, I'm actually starting with the last part of my lesson, which is the influence of Kiara. So it's like a fast forward. And then in the lesson, we will go a bit more into detail and understand what lies behind such an impact. So if you permit me, I shall screen share and we shall watch this video.
Kiara Lubick was born in Trent in 1920. At the age of 23, she consecrated her life to God. It was the founding event of the birth and development of one of the vastest ecclesial movements of our time, the Focolare movement. The adventure of the Focolare began in the context of World War II.
We saw that our small ideals were also going up in smoke. One of my friends wanted the house, but that crumbled. Another wanted to get married, but her fiancé never returned from the front. We were faced with the fact that everything crumbles, that everything is vanity of vanities. Yet I felt a question within me. Is there an ideal that does not crumble, that no bomb can destroy? I told this to my friends as well. Yes, there is. It is God. Let's make God the ideal of our life. God, who in that moment manifested himself as love. We believed in love.
In a few months' time, a community blossomed forth, modeled on that of the early Christians, whose only bond was evangelical love, characterized by a full communion of spiritual and material goods. It was a contagious way of life which quickly spread beyond the walls of the small city of Trent and was welcomed by people all over Italy and Europe. In 1959, it began to cross the European borders. A totally original characteristic is the fact that from the very beginning, Kiara Lubick and her movement were called to become witnesses in the world to a radically communitarian experience in conformity with the unity willed by Christ. Quite soon, the spirituality of unity penetrated the Orthodox, Anglican, Lutheran, and Reformed worlds, giving life to what has been described as the ecumenism of the people. The encounter with the major religious traditions of humanity has seen Kiara as an ambassador of peace, of dialogue, and of brotherhood around the world. But also those who do not have any religious affiliation find in the Focolare spirit a source of inspiration for their lives, and they feel urged to collaborate with it in defense of universal values such as peace, justice, freedom, and the protection of nature. Acknowledgements are made to the indisputable contribution given by Kiara's work and thought to the development of a culture of dialogue and peace. Thus, a variety of honors and expressions of appreciation have arrived, international prizes, from the Temple Prize for Progress in Religion to the UNESCO Prize for Peace Education, a dozen honorary citizenships, and just as many honorary doctorates from prestigious universities the world over. A trip to Brazil in 1991 gave life to the Economy of Communion project aimed at offering a response to the drama of the dire poverty of those populations.
Business enterprises should begin, and the management needs to be put in the hands of those who have the expertise and are therefore able to make the business work with the greatest efficiency. And the profits are to be put in common.
800 businesses that adhere to the Economy of Communion project in various nations of the world freely decide to share out the profits in three equal parts: for people with financial difficulties, for the formation of people to a culture of giving, and for the development of the business itself. The spirituality born from Kiara's charism imbues a wide variety of spheres, from politics to pedagogy, from art to medicine, from ecology to communication. Its most recent expression is the Sophia University, an authentic academic workshop or formation that joins research, studies, and experience within a community of life and thought. More and more people, in always vaster ways, adhere to the movement brought about by Kiara.
The hero,
people
you.
Of every culture, class and state in life, from every part of the world. The Focolare movement currently numbers approximately 2.5 million members and adherents in 182 nations, a people that wants to live like the early Christians. This model has inspired 35 little towns that have risen up throughout the world. Two-scale models of a society renewed by love, an eloquent demonstration that universal brotherhood, the plan of God for humanity, is not a dream.
When your day comes, my God, I will come to you with my wildest dream come true, to bring you the world in my arms.
Well, Kiara chose an ideal that no bomb could destroy, God. That was the light that she followed and which guided her to the end. How about taking a few seconds to respond to yourself and ask, what is my ideal, my goal, for which I am willing to risk everything? Kiara often used this expression, the pen does not know what it will write, the artist's brush does not know what it will paint. When God takes someone in hand to bring a new work into being, that person does not know what she will achieve. She is simply an instrument. But definitely, God prepares these instruments. Kiara too is a recipient of a charism. In fact, I want to make the lesson also a bit more interactive. So I wanted to ask you, does anyone want to share, what do we mean by the term charism? You can either put it in the chat box or you can unmute yourself. You may have heard the word charism. What could it mean? Let me see if anyone on the chat, you just type in what comes to your mind. Extraordinary power. Inspiration from God. Right, a charism is a gift.
I feel charism
yes.
is a, it's,
yes,
it's,
yes.
A it's a personal conviction that we carry on for throughout our life, for the good of others and also as well as for oneself.
Very good. You brought in a very important point, for the good of others and for oneself. Yes. In fact, when we say charism, it's really a gift, and also in the Christian term, it's a gift of the Holy Spirit, and that gives a founder. We have many founders, like for the Jesuits, we have Ignatius of Loyola or St. Francis of Assisi. They're people with great charisms who have turned a vision into action and have motivated many others. So the gift of the Holy Spirit and this a little bit of an extraordinary gift that Kiara received at the service of humanity was a bit particular, because Kiara's charism throws light on the revelation of Jesus through a very specific perspective taken from John's Gospel 17:21. As you, Father, are in me and I in you, may they be one in us. This prayer for unity is the last testament of Jesus, which he pronounced before his passion and death, and which sums up the very heart of his message, the reason why he came, to make us one among us and one in God. Unity, therefore, a yearning which is at the core of every human being, a need and a sign of our times. I chose to highlight a few initial episodes in the life of Kiara because they are fundamental to understanding how Kiara was being guided by the light of this charism, a light which entered and enlightened human realities from this perspective of unity, and also brought forth a spirituality which contains a collective dimension. This was mentioned a bit in the video. It's a dynamics of unity in plurality. As we saw in the video, Chiara Lubich was born in Trent, that's in the north of Italy. Her father was a socialist and was not religiously oriented, while her mother was an ardent Catholic. She had two sisters and a brother who later joined the Communist Party and opposed the fascist rule in Italy. Hers was a very close-knit family. Thinking of this background itself, we can see how an all-encompassing love that existed in this family with such diverse tendencies may have had an influence in Chiara's life. Even as a child, Chiara had a desire to know the truth about life, and she began to look for God at a very early age. As a young person during a retreat, Chiara visited the Marian Shrine of Loreto in Italy, which according to tradition, it says that this house was the house of the Holy Family of Nazareth, which was brought brick by brick to Italy during the time of the Crusades and reconstructed in the shrine. During her visit to this little house, Chiara had a deep spiritual experience as she contemplated the family of Nazareth who were living there, Joseph, Mary, and Jesus among them. This experience gave her the first intuitions to her future vocation. She knew it would be a new way, a new vocation as compared to the ones known at that time, that's married life, a convent, or a consecrated life in the midst of the world. She envisaged instead a fourth way, modeled on the family of Nazareth, where single and married people completely offer themselves to God. There are those who live in small communities in the midst of the world. But at the same time, she had no clear idea at all. She only knew that she would be followed by a multitude. As soon as she graduated, she took up a teaching job in an elementary school in Trent. An episode in July 1942 marks the beginning of a very important discovery for Chiara. We are already in the period of the Second World War, which was between 1939 to 1945. Chiara was in school one day, and a Capuchin priest who was known to her requested her to offer an hour of her day in prayer for an intention of his. Amazed at the generosity with which Chiara agrees to offer not an hour, but an entire day in prayer, this priest blessed her, saying, "Remember, God loves you immensely." The impact of these simple words, Chiara recounts, resounded in her like words of fire impressed on her heart. She was deeply struck and kept repeating it to herself and then to her friends that God loves them immensely. From that moment onward, she sensed the presence of God's love everywhere, in every circumstance. She perceived that everything was governed by love. It was as if till then, you know, she was living like an orphan. And finally, she had discovered that she was at the center of her father's love, and nothing in the world escaped his loving glance. Everything that happened, sad or happy, was part of his plan of love. We must remember that we are in the midst of a world war, and probably there were also people questioning the existence of God, or why was he allowing this to happen? In the midst of this virus, we can in some way relate to the situation. And yet, it's exactly in this context that God chooses to reveal himself to Chiara as love. But God is love is an affirmation already present in Christian scripture. But these words, perceived and understood by a particular grace, and here we see the charism at work, a particular grace of God, and not because of a fruit of reflection. This became a reality in Chiara's soul and in all to whom she conveyed this discovery, her relatives, her friends, the students. In 1943, this profound love for God, who became her everything, was sealed in an act of consecration of her life to God. Thereafter, some of her friends too, who were inflamed by this discovery, followed her. together, their greatest desire was to respond to God's love. So what did they do? They turned to the New Testament of the Bible, the Gospels, where they found in Jesus the way to love God. This was something unusual for young people, actually, at that time, to take the gospel in their hand, and they actually took it and tried to live it very seriously. And although they had heard those words before in church, due to a grace from God, they found that their minds were illumined by a new understanding, clarifying the deepest meaning of those words and giving them a drive to put it into practice. They lived every word literally and were amazed to see the promises contained in the gospel being realized in daily life. And they would share these experiences with each other, with the people whom they met, just to cite an example. So the war was on, and the city of Trent had fallen prey to the air raids, forcing all the inhabitants of the city to take refuge. Even 13 times a day, they were forced to run to the underground shelters. So Kiara and her friends, however, they gave themselves an appointment in one of these underground shelters, and they would continue to meet there. And among the few things that they could carry along with them, considering that to run out of the house so many times, was a pocket-sized gospel. They would randomly open it in candlelight and read it. Kiara had the impression that those words from the gospel seemed to be lit up from beneath by a divine light. And they were particularly struck by all the phrases that spoke about love. For example, love your neighbor as yourself, Matthew 12:31. They realized that their neighbors were all those people who needed their assistance to arrive to the underground shelters. So what did they do? When the sirens went off, instead of running to save their life, they ran to assist the people in need, risking their own life. And they were happy. Their serenity and joy in the midst of destruction, anger, hatred, selfishness caught the attention of many around. There were those who could not make sense of it, while others, fascinated by the new and practical interpretation of the gospel, joined them. So in just about 2 months, there was already a community of 500 people of all walks of life following their example. There are so many examples like these of the scripture, of how the scripture came to life, the way they lived it. Because scripture was no longer an object of reflection, but something to be lived to the letter. And they were also seeing surprising results. Maybe this could be a little exercise, a serious exercise that we can take as homework after this lesson. To really try and put the gospel into practice and see the letter and see the results. Kiara and her friends were strongly convinced that love conquers everything. It was like their new life. It was their being. So much so that they had this strange desire to be buried should they die in the war, and this could have happened. They wanted to be buried all together in a single grave without their names, but just an epitaph, just a lettering on the tombstone that read, "And we have believed in love." In fact, if you ever get a chance to visit the cemetery in Rome where many of Kiara's first friends are buried, this desire of theirs is symbolically represented with the photos of her companions, and in the center of the garden, a big tombstone that reads, "And we have believed in love." Years later, Kiara sees, even in this desire of theirs to be buried all together, a seed of a collective dimension of spirituality that was already manifesting itself. So till now we've seen that for Kiara, there was this discovery of God as love, not as an attribute of God, but his very being, and his love that manifests in everything that happened around. And the strong desire to respond to love that made them want to live his words and to love in return. January 1944, a few years later, marks a special encounter. One day, one of Kiara's friends had fallen ill and was unable to participate at the service in church. So Kiara requested a Catholic priest to administer the Holy Eucharist at her house. After the prayer service, this priest, in a short conversation with Kiara, asked her opinion on when Jesus suffered the most. Kiara answered, as per the common understanding then, she said, at the Garden of Olives, when in foreseeing his suffering and death, he sweated blood. According to this priest instead, the apex of Jesus' suffering was what he experienced on the cross when he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Saying this, the priest left. For Kiara instead, those words, once again, were like a lightning bolt. Her ailing friend, who was next to her, recounts how Kiara turned to her as soon as the priest left and said, if Jesus' greatest suffering was his being forsaken by the Father, then it's also the moment of his greatest love for us. We will choose him in this way, as our ideal. From that moment, Jesus forsaken, as they termed it, became the love of her life. Since that day, her friend says, Kiara often actually always spoke of Jesus forsaken. In this cry on the cross, Kiara had discovered the most hidden, interior, tragic suffering of Jesus, a spiritual one, that of feeling abandoned by the Father, God, out of love for us. In fact, in a letter dated 30th January, which is just after a week of this encounter, she writes, let's look for him and console him wherever he is suffering, in any suffering. Let's not run away from him, but embrace him in the many crosses of ours and other people's lives. And let us gather for him hearts that also start loving him. For a moment, could you think spontaneously of words that you identify with pain and suffering? Spontaneously, you don't have to think too much. What are the words that come to your mind when you think of pain and suffering? You can write it in the chat box. Anguish. Whatever you identify with pain and suffering, any word that comes to your mind, disconnection, rejection, right? Trauma. Loneliness. Right. Solitude. In fact, Kiara understood that in that moment of his cry of abandonment, the climax of his suffering, he actually experienced all of it. She had asked one of her friends to even look through a dictionary and pull out all the words that signify pain and suffering. And she said, in that moment, he faced it all. So what did they do? They began to recognize this countenance of Jesus forsaken in every suffering that they encountered, like the ones that you just wrote in the chat box. Whether it was physical or spiritual, in disunity, in hatred, in indifference, in the sin-ridden faces of those around them, in those who seem far away from God. Every suffering was a chance to love Jesus forsaken. He was their reason to go out and challenge every suffering with love. Jesus forsaken had become the living personality in their lives. and he began to reveal himself gradually to them. Now, knowing that they could die in any moment under the bombs, he asked themselves if there was something most pleasing to God that they could live before they die. Their eyes fell on the commandment of Jesus, which he termed as his and new. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down his life for his friends. Kiara, love of neighbor, was always central to the understanding of Christianity, but this was a different expression of love, and she called this the pearl of the gospel. And Kiara approached this commandment in a very practical way, by making a solemn pact, kind of a promise of mutual love with her closest friends, in which they promise each other the readiness to give their lives for one another. This was the measure they understood from those words of Jesus, as I have loved you. So with that benchmark, they were ready to give up everything or anything for the other, whether it was their time, their things, even their own ideas, preferences, their prejudices, everything out of love for the other. And this became a reciprocal attitude because they had made a pact to love one another in this way. Kiara says that from that moment that they started to live and renew daily this pact of mutual love, their life kind of took a qualitative leap. What happened? Living reciprocal love had confirmed what Jesus had said: where two or three are gathered in my name, in my love, as interpreted by the fathers of the church, I am in the midst. So through the practice of the new commandment, Kiara uncovers another real and tangible presence of Jesus, which probably had not been emphasized in its experiential sense as much as the presence in the word, in the neighbor, in the Eucharist. In fact, the life of reciprocal love firstly generated new light and energy to understand what it means to really love one another to the point of giving one's life. And secondly, they began to discern an almost tangible living presence of Christ among them. They would say it's as if someone entered their group silently, an invisible friend, giving them security, a more experiential joy, a new peace, a fullness of life, an inextinguishable light. It was Jesus fulfilling his promise of where two or three are gathered. For Kiara, this presence of Jesus was a real mystical presence, an ontological reality among them, a light that guided them, sustained them, like an invisible leader. And these are experiences not only of the beginning, but they still continue. So while the city of Trent was being heavily bombarded, many people, including Kiara's parents, fled to the mountains to find shelter. Kiara and her friends instead decided to remain back, to assist the needy in the city and to sustain the community of people who were connected with them. So they went to live in a small apartment together. And this little house became a place where whoever knocked found love. They were experiencing the hundredfold promise in the gospel: give and it will be given to you. They gave and they received in clothing, in food, in medicine, which was then redistributed to those in need. So it was constantly going on in this house. The poor were invited to eat with them at table. People began to call this little house the focolare. So the word focolare in Italian means fireplace. It's typical in houses in cold countries to have a fireplace. and this name stuck on and continued even later. This fire was the fire of Jesus himself, who present among those united in his name, and people perceived this presence whenever they came to that house. Their joy, their peace, their reciprocal love drew many hearts that were transformed by his warmth and his light. If you remember, it was the intuition at Loreto that she had in this little house of Nazareth, with Jesus among them, which was becoming a reality. We're still in 1944, and during one of the most fierce bombardments in Trent, Chiara and her friends, huddled inside an underground shelter, found themselves reading, surely not as a mere coincidence, the prayer that Jesus addressed to the Father on the eve of his passion and death, in which he asked just one thing for his disciples for all times, that they may be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may be brought to perfection as one. It was a moment of grace as these mysterious words of Jesus shone with extraordinary brilliance. And as Chiara herself says, these are her words, we read through the whole passage. Those difficult words seemed to light up for us one after the other. We felt we understood them. Above all, we felt the solid conviction that what was here before us was the founding charter of this new life of ours and of all that was to be born around us. We were convinced that we were born for that page of the gospel. Chiara and her friends were also conscious of the difficulty, if not the impossibility, of realizing such an arduous task of unity, that of being one here on earth as God is one. So, kneeling down in prayer, they asked Jesus to teach them how to live unity. And they felt drawn to offer their lives, to be his instruments, and to extend it to the whole world. There's an interesting fact that in that little house, initially they were just a few staying together, and probably none of them had moved out of their own city before. But they had already written the names of all the continents on the door of one of their rooms, and they would pray for these continents. They already had the world in their heart. And Chiara realized that their radical commitment to living evangelical love, especially the new commandment of mutual love, attracted the divine presence of Jesus. And it was his presence that made them one. Hence, unity, as she understood, is a gift of Jesus when he is in our midst. It's not something that we gain through our own efforts, but it is a gift that is given to two or more united in his love. But we can lay the conditions to make this possible by our reciprocal dying to self love, lived in our relationships to experience this gift of unity. Chiara realized, though, that unity in the fullest and deepest sense of the word springs forth from that hidden wound that God allowed her to discover, Jesus forsaken. She understood him as the source of unity, the key to unity, and also the supreme model for all those who want to be an instrument of unity. And here we are coming to the crux of the thought of Chiara. There is one little text that I want to read out to you that explains it. She writes, she's talking about Jesus forsaken. He who had experienced in himself the separation of people from God and from one another, and had felt the Father far away from him, was recognized by us not only in our personal suffering, which were never missing, and in those of our neighbors who were often alone, abandoned, forgotten, but we also recognized him in all the divisions, injuries, rifts, mutual indifference, whether big or small, in family situations, among generations, between the rich and poor, in the same church at times, and later between various churches, as later on between religions, and between those who believe and those who do not have a religious belief. And he was the one to teach us how to face them, how to live them, how to work together to overcome them when, after the abandonment, he put his spirit in the hands of the Father. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. In this way, he gave humanity the possibility to recompose itself and its relationship with God, showing the way. He revealed himself to be the key to unity. To hear Kiara. So unity and Jesus forsaken, for Kiara, are two sides of the same coin. So these were just the initial 5 years, 1943 to 1949, which were very intense, dedicated to living the word of God. It is said that they were so immersed in this gospel adventure that they probably didn't even realize when the war was over. From the radical life lived, a new spiritual current emerged and spread, involving people from all walks of life, from young people to the families, religious and priests. It was similar to the life of the first Christian community, of whom it is said they were one heart and one soul in Christ. Even the cardinal points of this new collective spirituality had taken shape, all points drawn from the gospel and directed towards living reciprocal love, aimed at fulfilling the testament of Jesus that all may be one. It's also striking that Kiara saw an immediate link. In fact, she says, Kiara observes right from the beginning between a link between this emerging spirituality and the mystery of the Trinity. In the spirituality of unity, the relationship with God, as Kiara says, is not twosome between two, but what Kiara terms as a Trinity, me, my neighbor, God. The neighbor is not an obstacle between me and God, but a sacred doorway through whom I come into God's presence and through whom God draws near me. When this love becomes mutual, Jesus is mystically present in the midst, and it is he who makes us one. Now, my neighbor is not only a doorway, but together with me, a complete edifice, a living temple to the most holy Trinity on earth. These initial 5 years were an important preparation for something extraordinary that was in store. And we are now in 1949. It was summertime, and Kiara and her friends went for a little rest up to the Dolomite, beautiful mountains in Trent. In that beautiful, harmonious place in nature, something unexpected took place. It turned out to be the beginning of an extraordinary period of mystical illuminations for Kiara, which lasted for months there and then continued for 2 years. It is in this experience that the charism of unity unfolds itself by a special grace of God in all its intensity, and it also lays the foundation for the nascent Focolare movement. It is this year that is known within the movement as Paradise 49, a period that indelibly marked the history of spirituality and of Christian mysticism, introducing the human being to a form of Trinitarian experience, which was not yet experienced till that moment. In fact, Kiara thereafter constantly drew inspiration for the work God had entrusted to her from this experience. Kiara described this experience as an entrance into the bosom of the Father. Through a special grace, she was able to see with the eyes of her soul the secrets of heaven and the vision of all uncreated and created reality. She penetrated, in as much as possible for a human being, into the mystery of the Holy Trinity. getting to know the mystery of Mary, creation, the new heaven and new earth, heaven and hell. She also understood God's plan for the movement. Even the most unimaginable ones, in forms that came or became clear to her much later. But what's the particularity of this mystical experience? It was that it was being lived collectively, that is, together with the small group that was with her. While Chiara was the center of the mystical experience, due to the life of unity, the pact of mutual love, living reciprocal, self-giving, like Jesus forsaken, the daily Eucharist, this small group had already been fused into one. That made this collective mystical experience possible because Chiara immediately shared her intellectual visions with them, drawing them into it. So it was as if they had been living it equally, and it was being lived by all of them. After that period, Chiara continued to look at the world in the light of those illuminations, which contained a vision of humanity rooted in interpersonal relationships with a strong Trinitarian imprint. The content of her mystical experience represents the hermeneutical key to everything that would happen thereafter, both in the terms of elaborations and diffusion, including the initiatives in the ecclesial, social, cultural, ecumenical, interreligious fields. Chiara intuited that the insights she had would contribute to social transformation and eventually translate into foundational documents for the folklorist's work in dialogue and culture, in which everything would be renewed. Politics and art, school and religion, private life, entertainment. In fact, in the years that followed, it was very difficult to keep pace with Chiara. There were always new developments, new avenues opening up. It seemed like the Holy Spirit was in a hurry. Most of the developments were unplanned and a fruit of her passion for unity of the human family and her complete openness to the promptings of the Holy Spirit through circumstances, contacts, events. We see this, for example, in the unexpected developments as early as the 1950s in the ecumenical dialogue for unity among churches in a moment when it was hardly spoken of in the Catholic Church. She spoke of the church as communion when very few did and anticipated several of the main themes of the Vatican II. Her dream for universal fraternity opened new roads to dialogue with faithful of various religions and with those with no particular religious affiliation for the renewal of society. A deeply rooted need for dialogue matured in Chiara, not as an instrument to achieve certain results, but as a way of being. In all of these encounters, she modeled the way of dialogue that derives from her spirituality. She followed the example of Jesus forsaken by stripping away or momentarily setting aside all the richness of her own tradition in her self-emptying love, making herself one with whomever she met. She entered in their worlds, their heart, their mind, and found brothers and sisters, fellow pilgrims. She found herself enriched by the deep realities of other religions and would reflect on how she found them related to her personal experiences. She was fascinated with similarities while always stressing that unity is possible even where there are differences. I once read an interview of Chiara where she was referring to her meeting with the Buddhist movement, Rishoko Sekai, a Japanese movement, but it can apply also to our Hindu-Christian dialogue. And she says, the diversity itself, meaning nationality, religion, culture, has made us understand how the points in common are not due to a human effort or project, but they must be a supernatural work of God for a purpose that God has in mind and that we fully do not know. So I think there's a lot more in common that we still need to discover in our different traditions. And that's why this journey of dialogue can be extremely enriching and exciting. Kiara's writings and reflections have given rise to new thoughts in economy, politics, dialogue, which continue to have resounding and prophetic relevance for our times. Although these insights on communion, fraternity, reciprocity stem from her deep spiritual experience, these thoughts took on a universal human dimension beyond any religious affiliation. And it's in the context of new social movements and projects that she founded, which are developing, that you heard also in the video, the economy of communion, the movement for unity in politics, etc. And it's not by chance that Kiara received many honorary doctorates from different universities in the most diverse fields, from social sciences to economics, from humanities to psychology, from philosophy to education, etc. In the early 90s, as the movement grew and its ideas spread beyond its structures, the specific characteristics of a new culture came into relief. This prompted Kiara to give rise to an international study center comprising of selected scholars and professionals in various disciplines who lived the spirituality. And along with her, they started to work on the elaboration of the charism of unity in the light of these mystical experiences of 1949. And a fruit of this is also the Sophia University Institute. Kiara also founded little towns, or we call them also mini cities, in different parts of the world, where inhabitants of all ages, social backgrounds, religious beliefs, and walks of life, who live there temporarily or permanently, try to live the gospel message of love in their daily life of study, work, family, art, sport, social life. They are a witness of a living laboratory of fraternity, dialogue, and reciprocity in action. Now, while all this was taking place, a variety of work, and the movement was spreading, this did not distract Kiara from her primary aim to follow God alone. Besides all her works, her mystical experiences, she felt she had to leave something more, her holiness. Not only her personal holiness, but a collective holiness, a sanctity of the people. She couldn't conceive holiness unless it was shared with others. In fact, in the 80s, she launched the idea of going on a sort of holy journey. This reinforced in everyone the desire for perfection in love and the conviction that it was possible to achieve it because no one was alone, but everyone journeyed together. In this collective way, Kiara writes, each individual can find his or her own personal perfection as well. People who in other spiritualities seek God within themselves are like people in a garden, she writes, filled with many flowers. They look and they admire just one flower. They admire, love, and adore God present within them. It seems to us that God asks us to look at many flowers because the Lord is present also in the other persons, at least potentially so. And just as I must love God present in me when I'm alone, I must love him in my brother or sister when he or she is beside me. Thus, I will not want to flee from the world, but to seek Christ in the world. I will not seek only solitude, but also companionship. Not only silence, but also conversation. And when love towards Christ in our neighbor is reciprocal, in this encounter, we live according to the model of the Trinity, where the two people are like the Father and the Son, and among them, the Holy Spirit comes powerfully with his gifts. He is the soul of the mystical body. Towards the end of her life, speaking of the movement to which she had given life to, and in which she saw herself reflected, Kiara expressed her profound desire to be able to repeat the words of a Belgian theologian, what we heard also in the video. On your day, my God, I shall come to you. I shall come to you, my God, with my wildest dream, to bring you the world in my arms. Kiara Lubich passed away on March 14th, 2008, leaving behind this legacy. Thank you.
Hello. Can you hear me? Am I audible?
We can't hear you, Caroline.
Sorry, Dipali, yes, over to you, yes.
Yeah, okay. Thank you for that wonderful presentation on Kiara Lubich. You said Kiara Lubich was not a saint in India, but when we listen to what she had to say, the message that she gave, it is so relevant with our Hindu tradition. As we celebrate 100 years of Kiara Lubich, we just finished doing that last year, celebrating 100 years of this beautiful soul who tread amongst us. You see, many things that Kiara said, they have a resonance in our Hindu scriptures. First, I would like to say that the Focolare movement is so relevant today because of the love of the call for unity in this world, which is being torn apart by so many prejudices, anger, and all kinds of negative powers that have besieged this world. Going through the episodes of Kiara, at a very young age, as you have pointed out, she had this intuition that she had this great love for God, for Jesus. And this we can talk about is like Ananya Bhakti, the Bhakti tradition of India, where a person submerges oneself in the devotion of God. So that is what Kiara did. When she had this deep spiritual experience of being one with God, and when the priest said, remember, God loves you, that was the time, you know, when she thought and she found that everything, there was love everywhere. So that is bhakti or prem that we say in our Hindi tradition. So the prem or love, that is the key to bringing unity, and also first is finding oneself. So she found that God is love. And I think that is the message we take from her, that if God is love, we need to not only experience the love of God in our hearts, but also love each and every human being here on earth as our brothers and sisters. So that is one message that we get. But this Ananya Bhakti, this ultimate devotion or unconditional devotion that she had for God, also was the grace of God. For example, when she says that they lived every word literally and were amazed to see the promises contained in gospel being realized in their daily life. So God chose them. So it is when you love God immensely, God chooses you. It is like in our Upanishads, they say, the Brahman is not, we cannot attain Brahman, but we cannot attain Brahman or the Supreme Deity or the Supreme Lord by a lot of learning, a lot of scriptures, having a deep intellect, or having heard many sermons. But this divinity, when it chooses you, it reveals itself to you. But that only comes when you have single-mindedly made a devotional contact with the Lord. So that I find finds resonance in Kiara's life, when she had totally surrendered herself, and that love was like the love of a child for the father and the father and father's love for the child. And it is also like the soham, when the we call the Brahman is us and the we are the Brahman. So that is the divinity in us is can be realized only when we have that deep love for ourselves. But she also talked about not only love for us, for our own sake, but for others as well. And that is what makes her unique, to love the neighbor as well. And the Trinity that she spoke about, that the neighbor is not something which is an obstacle, is not even a conduit, but the Trinity appears together. That means the love of God can be experienced by this unconditional love, because love can conquer everything. And in the midst of all kinds of suffering in this world, especially in today's world, in Kiara's time, it was the World War II, when there was suffering and there was all kinds of fear, and there was kind of fear and suffering all around. At the same situation is today, when in this pandemic, when we are scared, there is grief all around due to bereavements. People have lost their jobs. There is so much suffering all around, and that we need to look around and find and reach out to those suffering sufferers. That is the message we get from Kiara. That means reaching out to the humankind. Whatever we have to share with the others. Even the Vedic period, it says, a person who has everything but does not share with others, he attains only sin. He who eats alone, kevalagho bhavati kevaladi, he who eats alone only partakes of sin. So therefore, this is the message that we learn, that we should look around and console the people who are suffering, not only with words, but by true heart, with our whatever means we have. So that is the chance for us to reach out to the sufferers and to have the mutual love in our midst. So this is the commandment of God, which he gave us, that we need to love unconditionally. And that is the one here, the total surrender and the mutual love for each other. It is not a selfish love for us alone. The Ananya Bhakti, we can find in other religious traditions also, but sometimes we surrender ourselves to God only for our benefit. But here, this was special, that we surrender ourselves to God, for we can become an instrument for the service of humanity, so that we can love one another unconditionally. And this focalary movement, which began from there, where people came and started living together unconditionally. And that is one thing, that whoever came to that door was openly accepted. And we find that in our tradition, when we are told Atithi Devo Bhava, whoever comes to your door is the incarnation of God. Please accept that person, respect that person, and also give him all that you can. So here, the message of Kiara is very, very relevant today. And that is the should be the purpose in our life, to find God amongst us, to find God amongst the divinity. And also this focalary movement tells us that we can find God in everywhere. And when she said that people of all generations, in all family situations, whether rich or poor, belonging to the same church or the other churches, that means from different religions, they can all come together. And that is the way the Hindus believe also. Ekam sat vipra bahudha vadanti. The God is one, but people understand him with different names. But also, she called for this not only interfaith dialogue, but for an intergenerational dialogue. That is very important. It is so that religion is not only for the people who have grown old or who have nothing to do with this world. We have to stay in this world, yet stay spiritual, and reach out to all of us. Thank you for that message. So she said, like, unity and the suffering, the Jesus forsaken, are together. They cannot be inseparable. So this idea of getting everybody together is the theme that we have, like the Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam. The whole world is one family. That Kiara brought this message. So this becomes so relevant to us. And her vision of this universal fraternity, bringing humanity rooted in interpersonal relationship, is the message that we need to understand, assimilate in ourselves, and put into daily practice, which is very simple and which is a doable thing. So this dream of fraternity, so that it opens a dialogue for everybody. So it is treating everybody equally, finding the commonalities that exist in all the religions, finding the unity in diversity. That is the message that today we get from Kiara Ljubek's teachings. I had this good opportunity of visiting one or two of these small towns. I visited Tagaytay in one of our Religions for Peace Asia meetings. And then I saw firsthand for ourselves how people from different walks of life, different ages, they are together and staying and living the message of God. So, why has it gone off the screen? Can you hear me? Am I audible?
Yes, Dipali.
Yes. Yes.
And also, when she talks about all the religions, she went around, talked to the Buddhist in Rishokosaikai, talked to the Muslim followers. And from everywhere, she brought this message of love. And this is the message she gave us, that we also have in our Yajurveda, Ano Kratvo Yantu Vishvataha. Let noble thoughts come to us from all sides. Even the last message, last lesson we had on Tagore, Tagore had also said, I want my windows open so that noble thoughts can come to me from all sides. So this is a movement that Kiara Ljubek presented to us. And I think this is also a reflection of what we can do. And this also reminds me of the Samanasya hymns from the Rig Veda, which talks about the unity of mind. And I just quote only two verses, Sangachadvam Samvadadvam Samvo Manam Sijanatam. I will just give you the little translation. May we march forward with a common goal. May our thoughts and speech be in harmony. May we belong to one fellowship. May our hearts and minds be inspired by common ideals. May one and same be our resolve. May all our hearts be in harmony. One and the same be all our minds, so that all may happily consent. This is the message that the Rig Veda gives us. And I am so happy that we talk about Kiara Ljubek today. And this is a message that we need to translate in our lives. And this is a message, not only for the Christians, but to everyone. Another thing that strikes me most is that Kiara, in her youthful age, she had this spiritual experience. And she calls out to the youth of the world to take this message forwards. So she had started the Teens for Unity, for the children to come together. I have participated in several of these programs, and I find that youthful magic, it is very, very contagious. Even at this late age in my life, when I'm with the young people, we are all motivated to do more and more work. So I think Kiara Ljubek, even after the 100 years, she's so relevant today. And I'm so thankful that we are talking about this movement. And I'm sure each one of us will take this message home. Thank you. If you have any questions, we would like you to put them in the chat box. So please, now the floor is open for discussion and questions. So kindly put your questions in the chat box, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Dipali.
Caroline, I jumped in before because I just could not stop after the presentation.
Yeah, you did perfectly well because my earplug was in the wrong place.
I had some problem with the internet, you know, in the summer when the power supply is, taxed with so much. Thank you, yes. Caroline. Yeah.
But I wanted to thank you because with your words, you personified this Hindu-Christian dialogue, this dialogue of people that we live, no? So yes, our experiences together and experiencing Kiara's life by reliving, no? What she discovered, she was always, as Sherilyn said, no, she was always anxious to make it something in common, that it becomes the common good, no? So what we try to do now is to live these insights, no? So are there any questions? We have a few more minutes. I'm sure Sherilyn will be very happy to answer anything that you would like to know more about, something that was new today. So far we have thank yous and appreciation, no? Yes.
Thank you. So that is the message of Kiara. Sarve bhavantu sukhinaha, sarve santu niramaya, sarve bhadrani pasyantu, ma kashchit dukha bhag bhavet. That means lay all be happy, may nobody suffer, let there be peace and happiness all around. So these are the verses, you know, everybody knows about them. But these Hindu sayings and the traditions that we have, they have so much common with Kiara Lubich's messages. And the best thing is that these things are doable. These are not just spiritual things or some religious teachings, you know, that are very high or very... So we need to translate these things into our lives. And that is what Kiara has given our message.
I just want to... Yes, Caroline. Caroline, I would... So I really thank Sherilyn and Dipali Bhanot for complimenting each other. Sherilyn had given a brilliant presentation on Kiara Lubich and her vision of the family, Foco Lare. That is that the warmth is given to every human being and connecting it with the Indian concepts by Professor Dipali, that is Vasudeva Kudumbakam. I think it was a wonderful presentation, complimenting each other. So how the West and the East are not thinking differently, but see how it is evolving into a unity, peace, progress. So I think that is a wonderful complementarity between the moderator and the presenter. So hearty congratulations, and also to Caroline. So my request to the Professor Dipali will be that, you know, what you have said, or maybe, you know, we are really wanted to bring out a volume collecting all the lectures. You could also contribute an article from your perspective on Kiara Lubich and also the need of peace, progress through this interfaith dialogue, and from actually from your source of from the Vedas and the Upanishads. I think that would be a wonderful. So this is only my suggestion.
Thank you. I will try my best to give you a nice paper. Thank you.
Hey, Fadmathew, I see a raised hand, Brother Katari. I don't know if that is because...
Yeah, please.
You have a question. Can you unmute?
Yes. Once again, good evening, all of you. So I have a very small question, not a question, it's a clarification. As Kara has responded for the immense love of God, and I feel that everyone is called. And what is our, at the present time, what is that is stumbling block which is blocking us to respond to the God's call for the good of others, and also for the individual?
Thank you, Brother Tatari. I don't know whether we have a comprehensive answer, because this yes to God is not only of Kiara's time, it's not only of only great founders, but in every moment we are called. The invitation is always open. The invitation to respond is always open. Probably, I feel at some point of time, we tend to take our own scripture, and also Dr. Dipali had underlined it, even as a Hindu, but of any tradition, we tend to take it as something to be reflected upon, as something that inspires us, but it tends to stop there. We sometimes don't make that extra effort to really live it to the letter. I just gave one example of, you know, to the point of even risking your life to go and, you know, when the air raid shelter, air raids were on, instead of running to save their life, they were running in the opposite direction. But what drove them to do that? It was, that's why even the initial question, what is one's ideal? What you know, Kiara had her ideal, which was God who manifested himself as love. So that became the focus of everything that was done. And maybe we're called to once again take the scripture seriously and to try and live it, because from there are always new insights and new things are born. And we've seen that happening. And our stumbling blocks are often, you know, we think that, yeah, we put our limits to living, you know, and say, okay, till this point, okay, beyond that, you know, maybe it is only in the scripture, we cannot do it, you know, it's only said, but that's not true. And that's where we have to, you know, challenge ourselves and raise the bar higher. And when we do that, that's when the Lord really manifests himself. And then you understand how to take the next step. So very often we ourselves block ourselves. And another aspect that Kiara brings out, you know, is this dimension of the neighbor. And that can be anyone in your own religious congregation, in your family, in your real neighborhood. That the other is a chance for you to really love God, not a stumbling block. Very often we think that we only have to do charity, but we are called to build a relationship, actually. And that relationship sometimes is very challenging. But if we don't live, as the gospel says, then even that becomes a block. Instead, you know, there also we have to challenge ourselves further. So every time you take the next step, you find yourself walking. But sometimes we stop ourselves, you know, and don't want to take the next step. So I think the call to respond is really to each and every person, even irrespective of our religion, no? Because that's when we realize we find ourselves coming closer to one another. You know, like I think in one of the lessons also, one of the professors spoke about the sun and the rays. And even Kiara speaks about that. So each one trying to really put it into practice, the closer and closer you come to the sun, you realize you're coming closer to one another also. So these are the gifts then that God gives you when you correspond to that. So I think we are the ones who create these blocks. But if we let loose and really live, we ourselves will be inspired and we'll be surprised at ourselves. I don't know if that answers.
Yeah. Coming near to each other without being judgmental. I think being judgmental, you know, holds us back. So I think people need to come together without any biases. And the neighbor, as you said, could be anyone. And to love that person unconditionally. It's a very difficult thing to do, but that is what Kiara wanted us to do. And not to just read the scriptures and read them, just leave them there as lofty ideals. So the question was how we can live it. We can live it by being non-judgmental, I think.
I read the article which Cherilyn has written, and that will be sent to everyone who is participating in this discussion. And in that, there is a point which I think she did not mention. According to Kiara Lubich, the other is a door. I think that is something very fascinating. And that is a wonderful expression that, you know, the other is a door, while many other existential philosophers like Sartre and the others were saying that, you know, the other is a hell, the other is a weakness. So he limits my opportunity. So such things, but the other is a door to the new culture. So I think that is a very fascinating expression, which Cherline has already written in that by Kiara. Thank you.
Thank you, Father Matthew. Thank you, Brother Katari, for that question. And thank you for all who spoke. But I also want to thank everybody who participated. In a special way, I also mention Archbishop Joseph Perum Totam. He is a silent listener, but we're very grateful for your presence, Your Grace. He is the chairman of dialogue at the Catholic Bishop Conference of India. So yes, we are truly honored and we really appreciate you being with us, but also each one of you. So next session, we will have Bishop Thomas Dabre, who will speak to us about Sant Tukaram. And then we will share, as usual, on the WhatsApp group, so that you can reflect more. No, you will all receive, as Father Matthew said, the text of Sherilyn. And we would like you to express and explain how suffering transformed Chiara Lubich to make a decision to live a life of love, bonded together to form a human family based on sharing to achieve happiness. So a lot of food for thought, but I'm sure you will be eager to know more about Chiara and the Focolare. We will have another session, no? Because Chiara's life is so rich, no? And we could only share a little about her life today. But in another session, in a fortnight's time, will be more about the dialogue experience, no? What Chiara discovered and lived about dialogue in the widest sense, no? So thank you. Thank you, Dr. Dipali, for your moderation. Thank you for your sharing. Thank you, Sharana. Thank you, ECC, and everyone. Thank you.
Good night. Thank you, Dipali. Thank you.
Thank you to all the organizers. Thank you very much to all the participants.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you so much. God bless you all.